report.
Okay, thank you, Rudy. Let me also add my own welcome to the four new members of council. I look forward to working with you. I appreciate your willingness to serve on this important committee. I will also say at the onset, it has been a busy handful of months since the September council meeting. So there is a lot that has poured in that we want to update you about. So bear with me because there's many updates we wanted to share with you. Now, as always, the open session of this meeting of the council is being webcast live, but in addition, we are videotaping it and making these recordings available as a permanent archive on the internet, including both the presentations that you're going to see, but also the associated documents. And for those who are new to my director's report and to council meetings, be aware that we have an electronic resource associated with my director's report that's analogous to a supplemental materials section of a published paper. This is the URL where you can go to get to all sorts of associated documents. When there is, in addition to my presentation, which is available both as a PDF file and a PowerPoint file, we supplement many of the slides with electronic documents, websites, various other files we thought would be of interest. It's always indicated on the bottom right of a slide. And then this entire resource is archived permanently on our institute's website, genome.gov, as sort of a historic record of the meeting. Now, there's going to be several other presentations during the open session, in addition to my director's report. And I've tailored the my director's report around those presentations so that we're not too redundant. To begin with, later this morning, you'll be hearing from Dr. Terry Manolio, who'll give an update on the genomic medicine working group of this council. After lunch, Dr. Eric Borwinkel, also a member of council, will be giving a presentation on the Alzheimer's disease sequencing project. We'll then shift our attention for the majority of the rest of the open session and deal with a number of concept clearances. First, Joy Boyer will present a concept clearance for renewal of the Centers of Excellence in ELSI research. This will then be followed by a presentation of four concept clearances by Dr. Adam Felsenfeld, all relating to the renewal of the NHGRI genome sequencing program and collectively representing a continuation of the discussion of this renewal from the September 2014 council meeting. Specifically, these concepts will relate to the genome sequencing program analysis satellites, a genome sequencing program coordinating center, high-quality human and primate genomes as foundational resources, and comparative and evolutionary genomics. So that's will be the key concept clearance part of open session. And we'll then have two final presentations in the open session. Dr. Rongling Lee and Jacqueline Otis will give a biennial report on the inclusion of women and minorities in NHGRI-supported research. And then Rudy Pizzotti will go over the review of the statement of understanding between the Advisory Council and NHGRI. And that will then wrap up our open session. So what I'm going to do now is follow these seven areas of my director's report, which continue to be an excellent framework for reviewing the necessary things that we want to tell you about, starting with some general NHGRI updates. First thing I'd like to do is to call your attention to a new feature on NHGRI's website, genome.gov. Now, as you know, we have a very talented communications group at the Institute, and a priority area for them is the use of video for telling NHGRI's story to the public and to the research community. And one example of this is the routine video casting and video archiving of the open session of these council meetings. But another important project that they recently completed and was debuted at this past fall's American Society of Human Genetics meeting was a slick new 15-minute video that tells NHGRI's story from the beginning through today. It's a silent form video, but in doing so, it spotlights the Institute's major programs and research areas across all the divisions and introduces the various components of the Institute. This fast-paced video incorporates some rarely seen archival videos and photographs and really honors the pioneers and leaders that have contributed to the development and growth of our Institute. It's also readily updatable, and so it's something that we plan to sort of add major programs as they come on board and launch them. And I encourage you to view this at some point when you have about 15 minutes. And I really want to give a special shout out and thanks to Alvaro Encinas, and who's our Institute's videographer, who led a team of individuals to create this video-based story about NHGRI. In terms of leadership at NHGRI, in October, Ellen Rolfes was appointed the NHGRI Executive Officer and Director of the Institute's Division of Management. This is one of the Institute's seven divisions. This appointment followed a rigorous national search. Now, in this position, Ellen oversees all aspects of administrative management within NHGRI, including management analysis and evaluation, financial management, information technology, and human resources. She also serves as NHGRI's Deputy Executive Counselor. Over her impressive career at NIH, including 18-plus years at NHGRI, Ellen has worked in a variety of administrative management positions, most recently serving as our Deputy Executive Officer. While perhaps less well-known to members of this council, Ellen is incredibly well-known and well-liked among the NHGRI staff because it is widely appreciated that she works tirelessly and effectively to ensure that NHGRI is the best administratively managed institute at NIH. There have been several other changes with respect to leadership positions, particularly within the Division of Policy Communications and Education. The first of which, as you heard from Rudy's introduction earlier, was the appointment of Dr. Bob Wilden as the chief of the genomic healthcare branch. Prior to joining NHGRI, Bob practiced clinical genetics in the Pacific Northwest in both private and hospital-based settings. In addition to his tenure as a medical faculty member at several hospitals, Bob has experiences as a consultant on biomedical informatics software and as medical director of a clinical molecular diagnostics laboratory, which should provide him a very unique perspective through which to advance the activities of this important branch. We look forward to Bob's leadership in expanding NHGRI's support of educational resources and outreach to engage healthcare professionals and the public in genomics. This was a long search process, and in particular, I want to thank Dr. Jean Jenkins for her efforts during this time to ensure that the branch's initiatives were not only maintained, but expanded in scope and visibility, and I want to welcome Bob to the Institute. Meanwhile, a valuable member of my leadership team has changed his role slightly at the Institute. Vince Bonham was the founding chief of the Education and Community Involvement branch, a role that he really served in brilliantly in leading the branch for about 10 years. But Vince recently stepped down as chief of this branch so that he could focus more of his time on two other major roles at the Institute. Specifically, for the next phase of his NHGRI career, and Vince is going to spend more time on his own research within the Intramural Research Program Social and Behavioral Research Branch, as well as to devote more of his attention to his role as my senior advisor for genomics and health disparities. For the latter responsibility, he will assist me in steering NHGRI's research in the areas of health disparity and minority health, in particular by building bridges with other NIH institutes, as well as the extramural and intramural research communities, and also by promoting genomics and LC research in the study of issues that are important to health disparities and minority health. With the shift in Vince Bonham's role at NHGRI, we quickly launched a search for a successor to oversee the vibrant portfolio of activities underway in our education and community involvement branch. And I'm very pleased to report that last month we announced the selection of Dr. Carla Easter as the new chief of this branch. Carla served as the deputy chief of the branch for the last 2 years and has had an impressive career working with schools and teachers in developing science outreach programs for many years. And as deputy chief, Carla was instrumental to the successful development, launch, and ongoing tour of the Genome Unlocking Life's Code exhibition with the Smithsonian's National Museum of Natural History. So we're delighted to have Carla now leading this important branch of the Institute and are confident that she will simply rock in this new leadership role. Finally, in terms of major NHGRI leadership positions, I want to make you aware of a couple of important recruitments that are now ongoing, starting with specifically the chief of the Communications and Public Liaison branch, also part of our Division of Policy, Communications, and Education. Now, this branch chief serves as the overall communications director for NHGRI, working closely with Laura Rodriguez and myself in dealing with all aspects of the Institute's communications programs. The chief manages and leads communications and media relations activities across the Institute, as well as contributing to trans-NIH communications initiatives. This position is critical to achieving the Institute's aim to disseminate, explain, and highlight genomics research to the broader research community and also to the public. With this mandate, this individual works in close collaboration with almost with all other parts of NHGRI, but also across NIH and in some cases, the Department of Health and Human Services. So this is a very important recruitment for me and the Institute, so if you have suggestions for outstanding candidates or wish to provide more information to a colleague, please let me or Laura know as soon as possible, and I provide here the relevant contact information for Laura Rodriguez. There's another important recruitment that we want to bring to your attention, specifically for a medical officer in the Division of Genomic Medicine. That recruitment aims to help the Institute foster the application of genomics for clinical care. This medical officer will work closely with Terry Nolio, Director of the Division of Genomic Medicine, to identify evidence gaps and research needs critical to the integration and application of genomic information in clinical care. Current programs closely associated with this division are familiar to this council, and include the Emerge Network, the CSER Consortium, the ClinGen Resource, the Undiagnosed Diseases Network, and the Ignite Consortium. Upcoming opportunities are being identified in collaboration with the NHGRI Genomic Medicine Working Group that you'll be hearing a summary about later in the open session. And future programs are under development in areas such as pharmacogenomics and evidence generation. Well, the job ad will hit our website and the USA Jobs site on February 16th, but if you can already view ads in the New England Journal of Medicine, Cell, JAMA, and the American Journal of Medical Genetics. And if you have suggestions for outstanding candidates or you need more information, please let me or Terry know as soon as possible. And here I also provide contact information in this case for Terry Manolio. Now, for the last general NHGRI update, I want to remind you that at the September Council meeting, I pointed out that the final NIH genomic data sharing policy was published on August 26, 2014. Now, as of January 25th, just 2 weeks ago, all NIH intramural research projects, as well as grant or contract applications that include funding for the generation of genomic data, are expected to meet the expectations within the policy. Now, as chair of the internal NIH Oversight Committee for this policy and as director of the institute that has been a leader in data sharing practices for many years, actually dating back to the Human Genome Project, I'm committed to ensuring that NHGRI is a leader in implementing the genomic data sharing policy. So, over a year ago, I asked my staff and senior leadership team to begin planning and preparing for the consistent and fair implementation of the policy across the extramural research program and our intramural research program. And in addition to working on implementation of the policy within NHGRI, our institute staff members are coordinating with other NIH institutes and centers and participating in NIH-wide implementation activities so as to share our experiences in establishing processes, but also to learn from others and to leverage agency-wide developments. Now, this, we fully recognize, will be an ongoing process. At times, it's going to be quite challenging, but I really regard this as one of the high-priority areas for the Institute. So, moving on to general NIH updates. And it has been a very busy and exciting few months since the last Council meeting with respect to the attention paid to NIH by very high-level government leaders. So for starters, in December, President Obama visited NIH for the second time during his presidency. He toured the NIH Vaccine Research Center. He also gave a speech to a packed audience in one of the auditoriums in the Clinical Center. And in his remarks, the president praised the contributions of NIH staff in dealing with the ongoing Ebola crisis, including the care of Ebola-infected patients at the NIH Clinical Center. Now, unlike his previous speech at the NIH, for this particular visit, the president seemed to want to work the room, in at least the front of the room, after his remarks concluded. And while I was sitting in the second row, I was not going to miss the opportunity. No way I was going to miss the opportunity to shake the president's hand. Now, fortunately, what I lack in general athletic build, I make up with really, really long arms. And really did help in situations like this. So,
you got the shake.
I got the shake. Haven't washed the hands since.
Didn't
no, but you could tell they were watching me pretty carefully. Yeah. So.
Yeah.
So it didn't stop with the president's visit because then, just 2 weeks ago, Department of Health and Human Services Secretary Sylvia Burwell came to NIH to meet with a small group of NIH leaders, including me, as shown on this group photo that was taken, to discuss a few particular topics of interest, including clinical applications of genomics. And while at NIH, the secretary also toured the NIH Clinical Center, she met with patients, and she participated in a town hall meeting with the NIH staff, and I'll come back to that town hall meeting in a few minutes. But by far, the most exciting development relating to high-level government leaders and the NIH relates to a major new initiative recently announced by President Obama. Now, because of the importance of this initiative, especially for NHGRI, I thought that it was worth dedicating some of my director's report to describing the story behind the announcement and the current plans of this effort. Now, let me start to begin with. It's really important to remind you that President Obama has a longstanding interest in biomedical research, but in particular, genomics. For example, in 2006, then Senator Obama introduced a piece of legislation in the Senate entitled the Genomics and Personalized Medicine Act. Now, while this bill was never passed, it in many ways is emblematic of the genuine interest that the president has in genomics and the opportunities to individualize approaches to medicine. And throughout his presidency, his interest in genomics has grown. This, of course, has been nurtured by people that he interacts with on a scientific topics, such as NIH Director Francis Collins and also Eric Lander as co-chair of the President's Council of Advisors of Science and Science and Technology. For a number of reasons, this greatly intensified early last summer, eventually leading to a request from the president to bring him a plan for a bold new initiative that he could launch during the remaining 2 years of his presidency. Now, the president's interests have in fact broadened beyond genomics, and so we were asked to formulate our plan around the notion of precision medicine. And I think this broader context aimed to consider all elements that are relevant for individualizing medical care, with the goal, of course, of advancing human health. And as you will see, NIH was not alone among federal agencies in developing such a plan. But that said, a modest number of us from NIH work quietly and diligently throughout the summer and into the early fall developing a scientific plan for a possible presidential initiative in precision medicine. Now, our fundamental thinking about precision medicine was fairly simple and familiar to many of you. I mean, you know, today, we tend to deliver medical care based on the expected response of the average patient, and yet we know that that is far from perfect. And eventually, meaning tomorrow, we want to deliver medical care based on individual genomic and environmental and lifestyle differences and that enable more precise ways to prevent and treat disease. Well, in developing a plan for an ambitious initiative in precision medicine, we focused on research areas that needed to be accelerated to basically get us from where we are today to this new tomorrow. And so a number of us developed a plan by the early fall, and it was presented to the president, who very much embraced it. It then went through the process of being readied for inclusion in the president's fiscal year 2016 budget and for its announcement by the president. We were told to expect some mention of the initiative by the president in his January 20th State of the Union address, but to be honest with you, we had no idea exactly what he would say. We were delighted to hear more than we actually had anticipated he would say, and I'll show that here.
21st century businesses will rely on American science and technology, research and development. I want the country that eliminated polio and mapped the human genome to lead a new era of medicine, one that delivers the right treatment at the right time. In some patients with cystic fibrosis, this approach has reversed a disease once thought unstoppable. So tonight I'm launching a new precision medicine initiative to bring us closer to curing diseases like cancer and diabetes, and to give all of us access to the personalized information we need to keep ourselves and our families healthier. We can do this.
A couple things to note. First of all, I watched the entire State of the Union address. It was one of the few times that both Boehner and Biden clapped at the same time. That was good. And also notice people standing up on both sides of the aisle, which is why I let the clip go a little longer. So that happened at the State of the Union address. And then 10 days later, on January 30th, a couple hundred guests were invited to the East Room of the White House for a formal announcement by President Obama. Councilmember Bob Nussbaum was among the guests, as were a small number of us from NHGRI. That announcement took place. I was able to get a good center seat and took these photographs. He said among a number of very wonderful things in his announcement, and that's why the budget I sent to the Congress on Monday, again, this was all timed to the budget release, will include a new precision medicine initiative that brings America closer to curing diseases like cancer and diabetes and gives all of us access potentially to personalized information that we need to keep ourselves and our families healthier. So that was the announcement. But just as the president was announcing plans for the Precision Medicine Initiative on January 30th, this was coordinated so that the New England Journal of Medicine published online this perspective, co-authored by Francis Collins and Harold Varmus. And if you haven't seen this, I would encourage you to look at it. This paper provides an excellent summary of the general scientific rationale and the initial plans for the initiative. Now, let me just give you a few more details about this. I knew you'd be interested in this. It's really worth stressing that the Precision Medicine Initiative largely reflects ideas that have been considered before, in fact, ideas that have even been discussed at this council. However, it frames them in a new light due to some key developments that have occurred, and particularly over the last decade. Now, in my thinking, I think there's really five areas that I describe this as sort of being significant with respect to advances that have taken place in the, roughly the past decade that together really serve as the underpinnings for at least the early plans of the initiative. Those five areas are genomics, which I need to say nothing to this group in particular, spectacular the advances that have taken place in the last decade. Electronic health records, and numbers that are certainly pointed out by the White House and by associated documents with the announcement where something like a decade ago, maybe only about 20 to 30% of providers had electronic health records in place. Now that figure is over 90%. That growth provides grand new opportunities. Obviously, remarkable advances in technologies, in particular mHealth devices, such as shown here, but also smartphones. The number of smartphones being used in the United States has gone up 160-fold in the last 10 years, giving opportunities of communicating with individuals and having information collected on individuals' behalf. Something very familiar with this council, data science, biomedical big data, and all the things we've discussed in recent years that genomics exemplifies as providing and really giving great challenges, but also seeing some grand opportunities for integrating data across these various domains. But fifth and importantly, final, of course, has been a shift in many ways with what I sort of describe as sort of patient partnerships. We're finding ourselves in a new era. Some of it relates to having many more existing cohorts of individuals that are available for study, but also I think social movements, the citizen science movement, the crowdsourcing efforts and so forth, where patients really do, and individuals, Americans included, want to be active participants in research and through social media and other means, and I think just cultural changes, we have an opportunity to harness the energies and do things in ways that simply were not possible or we couldn't envision 10 years ago. So I think these five things very much have shaped the thinking that led to the Precision Medicine Initiative as currently envisioned. And it's currently envisioned as having sort of three major areas. First, there's a near-term effort that uses cancer as a model of precision medicine, recognizing that cancer is the leading edge of precision medicine, and yet there's so much more to be learned. And that if we could simply ramp up current efforts very aggressively and expand it to more cancer types, there might be some early wins that would clearly be of great benefit. Needless to say, the National Cancer Institute will play a major role in leading this near-term effort of this initiative. The longer-term effort realizes that we, of course, want to expand this model to go to other diseases beyond cancer, and in doing so, what the plan calls for, the creation of a national research cohort of over a million volunteers, and use that cohort in a productive way to generate the kind of knowledge base needed for advancing precision medicine. But also, it was recognized that it wasn't just a matter of near and longer-term research efforts, but we also needed some policy changes. So the initiative includes efforts to remove barriers to clinical implementation, particularly related to federal rules protecting research participants, but also advancing FDA's oversight of precision medicine products. So these are the three very broad stroke areas that are currently envisioned for the Precision Medicine Initiative. Now, as I mentioned earlier, the timing of the president's announcement was tied to the rollout of the fiscal year 2016 fiscal year budget, which includes a designated $215 million of new funding for the initiative within the president's budget. And the proposed amounts of the relevant three federal agencies are shown here. And you can see NIH with designated $200 million. I can tell you that $70 million of that is for NCI and $130 million is for other, mostly for the cohort, at least as currently envisioned. Now, I can tell you that one of the most gratifying and motivating aspects of the Precision Medicine Initiative, which was told to those of us involved in this for the past 6 to 8 months over and over again, is that President Obama's strong and personal interest in this initiative and the fields of study that it represents. Now, you know, we heard about this directly from Francis Collins many times, but it was particularly interesting to hear Secretary Burwell describe this during her recent visit to NIH. So she held a town hall meeting with staff, and questions were submitted. And one of the questions that she answered was as follows. It was something along the lines of, you work very closely with the president on a regular basis, and based on what you know about the president, you know, tell us a couple of things that would be of particular interest to NIH staff. And here's what Secretary Burwell had to say.
But with regard to a couple things about the president, two things that I think are important to know that could help you in your day-to-day work. The first one is, and I'm sure you've told the team this, the precision medicine thing, that's him. This is like a presidential priority. This is the amount of time that is being spent on this issue by the President of the United States relative to, I could go through a whole list of issues, is incredible. And so what you should know and what you should take from that is this is his own personal interest. It is what you all do. It is, he believes so much that this is about our nation's innovation in science. He believes this is about our economy. He believes this is about the health and welfare of our people. And so this, while it's precision medicine, it is a, I think it gives you a view into his thinking about the work you all do every day.
So, pretty remarkable. It's, again, consistent with what we were being told. Not surprisingly, since the announcement, there's been considerable press coverage about the president's announcement, with examples from the popular press shown here. By and large, it's been mostly good press. As always, some issues have been raised, but I think by and large, I think we're pleased with the coverage it received. Similarly, there have been multiple stories published about the initiative in the scientific press, I think similarly generally positive and encouraging about what has been laid out, at least so far. It's also important and gratifying to see that there is some early evidence that the Precision Medicine Initiative, while announced by the president, will hopefully engender bipartisan support. To be successful, we're going to need bipartisan support, needless to say. You know, for example, in this New York Times article, Senator Cassidy, a Republican from Louisiana, was quoted as saying, "This is an incredible area of promise." He is a physician, a gastroenterologist, but he did point out there will be bipartisan support, and hopefully he can deliver that. At least there's a good signal of bipartisan support. Among the major elements of the initiative, I just do want to stress and give a little bit more input about the middle one, this cohort, in particular because this is where NHGRI expects to be actively involved. And in fact, a number of us, I counted up, at least 10 of us have been involved at various levels throughout the summer and now in particular leading up to the announcement and what's going to take place later this week, which I'll tell you about in a minute. There's been active involvement of a number of us, and I'm sure that will continue, although a lot of things are still not defined. But let me drill just a little bit more about what's currently being envisioned for this national research cohort. It is envisioned, at least right now, as having sort of something over a million U.S. volunteers. These are not going to be all new individuals. It really expects to take significant advantage of existing cohorts, many of which have been funded by NIH, but also recognize that that won't cover it adequately, and so almost for certain we will need new volunteers to fill in gaps and make sure all the appropriate demographics are appropriately examined and considered and included. The idea, of course, is to have participants share genomic data and lifestyle information, biological samples, importantly, have all of this linked to their electronic health records, which is, again, one of the reasons why now is so different than, say, 10 years ago. The idea is, and it has come out of discussions at this council proceedings, but also at workshops we have had, that if you had such a cohort, It would provide remarkable platform for all sorts of new studies to propel our understanding of health and disease. But we don't want to just do it the way we've always done it, and this is where I really do think that we want to develop new model or models for doing science that emphasizes engaged participants, open, responsible data sharing, and of course, ensuring strong privacy protections. And from the earliest planning and discussions for developing such a research cohort, it was recognized that new thinking and new ideas were going to be needed with respect to the participants and the data and the research, sort of the three major columns on this slide. I can tell you that for the participants, the initiative will aim to develop new models for consent and recruitment of participants. Certainly with respect to data, the data science opportunities created by the establishment of such a centralized database with the cohort, you know, especially in the areas of data integration, I think are going to be spectacular, albeit with lots of challenges. And finally, for the research itself, one can certainly envision building a new multidisciplinary scientific community centered on the cohort, both to do very basic-oriented disease discovery research, but also to pursue more medically-oriented studies related to clinical management. And I would also point out that in each of these areas, we've become aware of significant private sector interest in the initiative, and so hopefully this will become a fertile area for new public-private partnerships and collaborations as well. Now, we don't really pretend to have a detailed plan yet, but we knew we were going to need to get to work very quickly following the announcement. And so actually, a couple of months ago, we decided we would go ahead and schedule a workshop, hoping that all the announcement would happen in time. It all did. But actually, NHGRI and NHLBI organized this workshop and invited people to it. And now it's becoming basically an NIH workshop on behalf of the Precision Medicine Initiative. And so this is a workshop that we've been working on behind the scenes for quite a number of weeks. But specifically, the 2 days after this council meeting later this week, we're going to hold this workshop focused on building a large U.S. cohort. The workshop will involve representatives from a wide variety of fields and domains, including genomics, data science, electronic health records, mobile technologies, policy, ethics, law, epidemiology, patient groups, industry, government, and healthcare. We had a great group of people coming since the announcement. We've been overwhelmed with requests to come, and unfortunately, that's just not possible because of space constraints. But nonetheless, the discussions we fully expect to be quite important in shaping the early vision for this cohort. Are going to include cohort identification and participant recruitment, participant engagement, data privacy, and novel ways of returning information to patients and participants, data collection, including mobile health technologies, and informatics and electronic health records. Now, recognizing the interest in this and the incredible outcry of interest in additional people coming, we are video casting this live and also video archiving the entire workshop for future viewing. I can certainly tell you that in addition to that, we are going to make sure that we regularly update this council because we know that you're going to be very interested in as things play out. If you want to read more, there's now a dedicated website for the Precision Medicine Initiative at the White House. It has lots of things, videos and various documents, but in addition, you might not be surprised to hear that we also launched one at the NIH, which is really easy to remember in terms of its URL, and it has lots of information already up there. But notice there's a link right there to this workshop that's taking place later this week, and if you click on that, you will get to here, and here you will see information on how to not only get to the video cast and eventually the video archives, but already posted, and they just went up over the weekend, are 4 white papers that have been developed that will be the fodder for active discussion at the workshop, and you could all get to those white papers and see them anytime you want, including now, or certainly after my director's report. Okay, so that's what I wanted to share with you about the Precision Medicine Initiative, and at the end of director's report, happy to take questions that you might have. So, but again, there's been a lot of other things going on since the last council meeting. We finally have confirmed and now serving a new Surgeon General, Vivek Murthy, who's now the 19th Surgeon General of the United States. He was co-founder of Doctors for America, which focuses on advocating for affordable health care for all Americans. And it's great to have a Surgeon General now in place. Last week, there was yet another development of relevance in terms of leadership within the Department of Health and Human Services. The FDA announced that Dr. Margaret Hamburg, the U.S. FDA commissioner, is stepping down at the end of March after 6 years of heading the FDA and overseeing public health initiatives ranging from tobacco control and food safety to personalized medicine and drug approvals. Dr. Hamburg's public health focus has been a hallmark of her career, a constant champion for patients' health. During her time as FDA commissioner, Dr. Hamburg was committed to fostering the growth of science and innovation across the agency and changing how the FDA and industry collaborate. Dr. Hamburg leaves a strong legacy of accomplishment at the FDA. Dr. Steven Ostroff, the FDA's chief scientist, will serve as acting FDA commissioner, and NHGRI will continue watching with keen interest FDA's involvement in genomics and its movement into the clinical sphere. At the NIH level, there's some leadership changes going on as well. Late last year, Don Lindbergh announced that he will be retiring from federal service at the end of March. Don has served as director of the National Library of Medicine for more than 30 years. During his tenure, he led the library's transition into the electronic informatics age and oversaw numerous landmark projects, including the launching of the Medline database via PubMed, clinicaltrials.gov, the Unified Medical Language System, and of particular relevance to the field of genomics and NHGRI, the National Center for Biotechnology Information, NCBI. Well, when Don departs, Deputy Director Betsy Humphreys will step up and serve as acting director of the NLM. Now, while Don Lindbergh leaves behind an icon of an organization at the NIH, nonetheless, the National Library of Medicine has been a center of information innovation since its founding in 1836. But at the same time, you know, lots of things have changed with respect to how health information and biomedical information are collected, shared, and analyzed. And we've also shifted from largely print to largely digital media, and we really are seeing ourselves transitioning into a data-intensive era. And so NLM's role really probably needs to evolve to continue meeting the many challenges in information and data science. And so rather than immediately launching a search for a new director of NLM, NIH Director Francis Collins has decided to first pause and strategically consider the role that NLM should play in the current and future biomedical research enterprise. And so to carry out a renewed visioning process, he has established a working group of his advisory committee to the director, or ACD. Now, I was actually asked to co-chair this working group along with ACD member Harlan Krumholtz of Yale University. The working group is charged with reviewing the mission, organization, and programmatic priorities of the NLM and articulating a strategic vision for the NLM in order to ensure its continued leadership in the field of biomedical and health information. Specifically, the working group will address how the NLM should continue to meet the rapidly evolving scientific and technological needs of the biomedical community by developing and adopting information technologies, providing growth of the open access movement, maximizing usefulness and cost efficiency of NLM's archives, and interfacing with NIH's broader efforts to address major data science challenges facing biomedical research. The working group is on a short timeline, though, and we have to present our final report for consideration at the June meeting of the ACD. I would also point out that a website has now been established that contains all the relevant information about the efforts and products of this working group, and I'd certainly be interested if council has any ideas or input to the process. We would greatly value that, as the working group is now getting quite active. Another working group of the advisory committee to the NIH director recently finished its evaluation of the National Children's Study, a longitudinal observational study examining the effects of a broad range of environmental and biological factors on children's health and development. The study was envisioned to follow 100,000 children from womb to age 21. The working group concluded that, quote, the overall goals of examining how environmental factors influence child health and development are meritorious and should continue to be a priority for future scientific support. But the National Children's Study as currently designed is not feasible, end of quote. The NIH director has agreed with this assessment and has moved forward with the cessation of the National Children's Study. Data and resources produced from early pilot efforts will be made available to the research community. One of the 27 NIH institutes and centers recently underwent a name change. Per language included in the fiscal year 2015 budget, the National Center for Complementary and Alternative Medicine, or NCAM, was recently changed to now be the National Center for Complementary and Integrative Health, or NCCIH. The new name more accurately reflects the center's mission and research agenda. Other leadership updates. Dr. Carrie Wolinitz has been named and appointed the new NIH Associate Director for Science Policy and is also the director then of the NIH Office of Science Policy. She comes to NIH from the Association of American Universities, where she served as Deputy Vice President for Federal Relations, primarily working to coordinate advocacy on funding and policy issues relating to NIH and biomedical research. She also serves as the current president of United for Medical Research and is an adjunct assistant professor at Georgetown University. Now, Carrie takes over for Dr. David Sherliff, who took on the role of acting associate director for data science after Dr. Amy Patterson became the associate director for biosecurity and biosafety policy. A good friend of NHGRI's, Judy Greenberg, was recently appointed the deputy director of the National Institute of General Medical Sciences, NIGMS. She has a long record of dedicated service to NIGMS and NIH, including two extended stints as acting director of NIGMS. So congratulations, Judy. Now, in terms of activities within the U.S. Congress, in my September director's report, I described how the Energy and Commerce Committee of the House of Representatives, led by Chairman Fred Upton and Representative Diana DeGette, had launched the 21st Century Cures Initiative in June 2014. I also noted that the committee held multiple roundtables and hearings around the country, one of which I participated in Colorado, to solicit suggestions about the role that Congress could play in accelerating the pace of scientific discoveries and their translation to treatments and cures. Now, the committee had previously indicated it would introduce legislation based on the feedback it received, and accordingly, on June 27th, it released a discussion draft of legislation entitled the 21st Century Cures Act. Now, the draft bill, at nearly 400 pages, contains numerous provisions affecting NIH. Specific to genomics, there are placeholder sections called precision medicine, not surprisingly, and modernizing regulation of diagnostics, but no proposed bill language is there yet. And while the draft bill was released by Chairman Upton, it does not yet appear to have bipartisan support based on a number of news stories. But nonetheless, committee Democrats continue to express their hope for a bipartisan consensus on the bill. On the Senate side of things, the Senate Health, Education, Labor, and Pension, or HELP Committee Chairman Lamar Alexander and Senator Richard Burr recently released a report detailing their plans to assess the impact and efficiency of the FDA and NIH. Entitled Innovation for Healthy Americans, the report details their perceptions of the inefficiencies of the integration of new medical discoveries into patient care. The senators will be soliciting feedback on the report, including through a series of hearings as they begin to examine the time and cost currently involved with the drug and medical device discovery and development processes, as well as how public policies could be better aligned to support medical innovation. Now, the jurisdiction of the Senate Help Committee is similar to that of the House Energy and Commerce Committee, and there are many similarities between this report and the issues that the 21st Century Cures Initiative is seeking to address. But of course, to become law, the 21st Century Cures Act will have to be approved by both chambers of Congress. And the report from the HELP Committee shown here is a way for the Senate to contribute its own proposals to the discussion. Now, Representative Upton has set the goal of Congress sending a bill to the President by the end of 2015. However, Senator Alexander has not indicated whether he shares this goal or not. So we are obviously watching all of this closely because of its obviously a potential impact on the Precision Medicine Initiative specifically, but also on the NIH more generally. Of course, all of this is then relevant to budget matters. And with the passage of an appropriation package dubbed the Cromibus Bill in December, at least we now have a budget for this year. So we now know NIH's and NHGRI's fiscal year 2015 budget, which is indicated in the middle column. So out of NIH's $30.3 billion, NHGRI is a little over $499 million, an increase of about 0.3% over fiscal year 2014, which is shown on the far left. So of course, that's this year's budget. All this discussion in both chambers of Congress relate to next year's budget. So the focus now shifts to establishing funding levels for next fiscal year. So accordingly, last week, I talked about it already a little bit, the President has sent his fiscal year 26 budget proposal to Congress. And that's indicated in the far right column. The President's budget requests $31.1 billion for NIH, including that $200 million I told you earlier for the Precision Medicine Initiative. NHGRI would receive $515 million, which would reflect a 3.2% increase over the current year. Of note, NHGRI's congressional justification, or CJ as we wonks refer to it, is available now on genome.gov with a direct link provided under document 17. Now, within the CJ, if you want to review it, you can find both a narrative explanation for the major NHGRI programs, as well as a breakdown of how the Institute anticipates allocating dollars requested by the president, if received. Well, congressional groups will now examine this proposal through hearings, but at the same time, before, you know, we know we're going to have a long wait before we really know what NIH or NHGRI's final fiscal year 26 budget is actually going to look like. However, looking at all the recent attention and interest at the highest levels of the administration, also seemingly both chambers of Congress, particular about the opportunities with genomics, it's clear that our field of interest is going to be a significant part of the conversation in the weeks to months to come, which is actually a good thing. So let me move on then away from NHGRI NIH updates, now start focusing on genomics updates. Starting with a recognition that a genetics legend, Mary Lyon, passed away in December. Mary developed the idea of X chromosome inactivation, a process that came to be known as lionization in honor of her theory. Late last year, President Obama awarded the National Medal of Science to Bruce Alberts and the National Medal of Technology and Innovation to NCI's own Doug Lowy and John Schiller. These awards are our nation's highest honors for achievement and leadership in advancing the fields of science and technologies, and these honorees are all good friends of NHGRI's. Another good friend of NHGRI, Mary Claire King, was recently awarded the Lasser Koshland Special Achievement Award in Medical Science for her bold, imaginative, and diverse contributions to medical science and human rights. Mary Claire played an instrumental role in the discovery of the BRCA1 gene associated with hereditary breast and ovarian cancer, and also deployed DNA strategies to reunite missing persons or their remains within their families. The American Society of Human Genetics gave awards to three members of our community at their 2014 annual meeting in San Diego. First, Dave Valley was the 2014 recipient of the Victor A. McCusick Leadership Award for professional achievements that have fostered and enriched the development of human genetics, as well as its assimilation into the broader context of science, medicine, and health. And Gonzalo Abacasis and Mark Daly were the 2014 recipients of the Kurt Stern Award for significant genetics and genomics scientific contributions during the past decade. Congratulations to all of them. Other prizes. The Breakthrough Prize in Life Sciences recognizes excellence in research aimed at curing intractable diseases and extending human life. Of relevance to genetics and genomics, the 2015 Breakthrough Prize Life Sciences was awarded to Jennifer Dauda and Emmanuel Charpentier for their work on CRISPR-Cas9. In addition, Gary Rufkin and Victor Ambrose were honored for their exploration of microRNA-based gene regulation. Other honors included the Institute of Medicine, who recently announced their newly elected members, and of relevance to our community, new members included Gonzalo again, Todd Golub, Julie Johnson, Harry Orr, and Joe Takahashi. Congratulations to all of them. And similarly, an impressive field of individuals from our community were recently elected as fellows of the American Association for the Advancement of Science, or AAAS. The names are listed here. Congratulations to all of them as well. We could continue tracking the movement of genomics notables, one of which was Hunt Willard, was recently appointed the new director of the University of Chicago Woods Hole Marine Biological Laboratory. Congratulations, Hunt. And many of you probably have heard that David Altshuler has joined Vertex Pharmaceuticals as Executive Vice President of Global Research and Chief Scientific Officer. So congratulations to David as well. Moving from people to institutions, and certainly of interest to Carol Bolt, a member of this council. Last October, I was invited by Ed Liu and Charles Lee to participate in the ceremonial opening and ribbon cutting for the Jackson Laboratory of Genomic Medicine. I also spoke at their opening scientific symposium. The Jackson Laboratory for Genomic Medicine is a nonprofit research center that identifies the precise genetic cause of diseases and spurs the development of individualized plans of treatment and prevention. With 150 employees hired to date, the 184,000 roughly square foot facility expects to house about 300 biomedical researchers, technicians, and support staff over the next 10 years. It is an impressive facility, and it was fun to participate in their opening events. When The Scientist came out with its top 10 innovations of 2014, genomic technologies dominated the list. In fact, each of the top five innovations on their list involved some aspect of the process of genome sequencing. These include the Dragon Bio IT Processor by Itico Genome, Illumina's MySeq DX, Illumina's HiSeq X10 system, the Iris Chip V2 by BioNano Genomics, and the Raindrop Digital PCR system by Raindance Technologies. All pretty impressive. Featured as an NHGRI Genome Advance of the Month since the last council meeting have been publications describing the genomic origins of the 2014 Ebola outbreak, artificial sweeteners and the gut microbiome, genetic adaptation of the human circadian clock, supercentenarian genomics, and most recently DNA testing to detect cancer precursors in blood. Recent prominent genomics in the news stories include a Forbes article about cancer genome testing, an article in the New York Times about the funding climate for young scientists, a Wall Street Journal piece on newborn genome sequencing, a report at Genome Web regarding Google's plans to cover cancer genome testing for its employees, and lastly, an article in The Scientist about council member David Page, shown here, and his remarkable research career studying the Y chromosome. Congratulations, David. And in terms of genomes in the news, as always, there's a number of newly generated genome sequences reported since the last council meeting, including the Oxytricha germline genome, the Glanville fritillary butterfly, gibbon, 16 anopheles species, the house fly, a modern human man who lived in Siberia 45,000 years ago, a snub-nosed monkey, a koala, ferret, orchid, a centipede, four species of mud skippers, the bowhead whale, multiple cat genomes, and literally a flock of different birds. So, as always, comparative genomics, active as could be. So, moving on then, let's go through some major summaries of our extramural research program. Now, following the discussion at the September Council meeting about renewal of our genome sequencing program and approval of two initial concepts, NHGRI released two RFAs in mid-December. One RFA is for the new Centers for Common Disease Genomics program, while the other is for the continuation of the Centers for Mendelian Genomics program. Now, these are the first two RFAs associated with what will be the new NHGRI genome sequencing program. For these two published RFAs, NHGRI will host an applicant information webinar on February 18th, and then the submission deadline for both RFAs is April 7th. Now, later in this open session, you'll be hearing additional concepts presented that reflect several additional proposed components of the new NHGRI genome sequencing program. In terms of recent developments with our current program, the large-scale sequencing analysis centers, of course, that's the largest component of the current program, seek to address major biomedical questions by conducting very large genome sequencing projects. For example, the center's publishers submitted 54 new papers in the most recent quarter, reflecting projects across a range of areas, including the microbiome, comparative genomics, inherited disease, cancer, and technology development. One of their larger recent projects is the Alzheimer's disease sequencing project, that Councilmember Eric Borwink will be making a presentation about later in the open session. Of course, another major focus of these large centers has been finishing up the Cancer Genome Atlas, or TCGA. Exome sequence data production was completed in January 2015. However, analysis continues, and the project is scheduled to officially end in spring of 2016. This graph on the left shows the number of tumor normal pairs with exome sequencing data broken down by cancer type. This sequencing data was generated with over 10,000 tumor normal pairs and is publicly available in the Cancer Genomics Hub, or CG Hub. The other genomic characterization data is available through the TCGA Data Coordinating Center. Now, tumor-specific analyses remain a major focus for the TCGA. Now, for each of over 30 cancer types, the TCGA network plans to publish a comprehensive integrative analysis of genome sequence and mutation data, also copy number variation, gene and microRNA expression, and promoter methylation. The table shown on the right shows the status of TCGA publications, and there are currently an additional 15 analysis working groups actively involved in preparing publications. The TCGA paper on papillary thyroid carcinoma was published in Cell in October, and then the head and neck squamous cell carcinoma manuscript was published and featured on the cover of Nature in January, as shown here. Second major component of our genome sequencing program, the Centers for Mendelian Genomics, was established 3 years ago now with the aim of finding the genomic cause of as many Mendelian conditions as possible. To date, these centers have been responsible for the discovery of over 600 causal genes for Mendelian conditions, and some of those discoveries have been reported in over 125 publications. Now, these centers also undertake a number of activities to facilitate project coordination and collaboration and to avoid unnecessary duplication of effort. So, for example, they publicly post their joint project list at the program's website, an example of which is shown on the right, and they update that list regularly. And this list is downloadable and includes Mendelian conditions that have been investigated and the conditions that are being investigated by the centers and their collaborators. It is also annotated with OMIM numbers, the center site at which the project is being performed, and whether or not the center is interested in getting additional cases or not. And the list currently includes close to 1,000 Mendelian conditions. Another service offered by the Centers for Mendelian Genomics Program aims to enable connections between clinicians and researchers from around the world who share an interest in the same gene or genes, particularly when a gene-phenotype relationship is not yet completely established. So towards that end, the Baylor Hopkins Center has developed the software tool Gene Matcher, which has been freely available since December of 2013. And at this site, investigators can post information about genes of interest and in turn be connected with other investigators who post information about the same gene. Now, Gene Matcher has been used by a rapidly growing community of researchers since its launch. For example, this bar graph shows the number of submitted genes, submitted investigators, submitting countries, and successful matches made by last August, 2014, in the darker color, and also in January of this year in the lighter color. So for example, by January, 108 matches have been made out of the 1,493 genes that were submitted by 251 investigators from 29 countries. And it's expected that many of these matches will lead to a productive collaboration on finding the causal gene for a particular Mendelian condition of mutual interest. The third component of our genome sequencing program is, of course, our genome sequencing, our Clinical Sequencing Exploratory Research, or CSER program. This focuses on the integration of genome sequencing into the clinical workflow, including the generation, interpretation, and reporting of genomic information. CSER has now enrolled over 3,000 adult and over 700 children as participants, over 2,600 of whom have had germline genome sequencing data generated, and over 500 of whom have had tumor genome sequencing data generated. Two recent papers highlight the diversity of data being generated by CSER investigators. In a genome research paper that is just out online, CSER's Actionability Returner Results Working Group reviewed the interpretations of 663 genomic variants from 6,500 individuals and concluded that the rate of secondary findings in individuals is about 1 to 2%, depending on ancestry. This work highlights future opportunities to improve genomic variant interpretation. In a second paper, investigators at the University of Washington developed a decision modeling framework, as shown here graphically, for assessing the clinical and economic impact of returning secondary findings. Incremental cost-effectiveness ratios range from 45,000 to 115,000 per quality-adjusted life years gained, depending on the clinical context. The CSER Outcomes and Measures Working Group is expanding work on the cost effectiveness of clinical sequencing and organizing cross-site analyses. As one measure of overall impact, CSER has generated over 130 publications, including 9 working group publications. To date, CSER work has been featured in over 200 presentations and posters, including at several recent national meetings and roundtables. For example, CSER was prominently featured at both the American Society for Human Genetics and the American Society of Bioethics and Humanities in October, both meetings in San Diego. In total, there were 30 CSER posters and 19 CSER talks at these two meetings. In addition, the Institute of Medicine held their 20th roundtable meeting on translating genomic-based research for health in January in Washington, D.C. At that meeting, CSER investigators reported on the incidental findings and evidence assessments for returning results from genome sequencing. The final component of our current genome sequencing program, the Genome Sequencing Informatics Tools, or GSIT program, is known publicly by the name iSeq Tools. The program is comprised of six projects that develop approaches to provide researcher-friendly sequence analysis tools. The program has developed a method to combine and evaluate multiple variant calls produced by different prediction tools, making this challenging task easy and reliable for users. And specifically, iSeq Tools provides GKNO, pronounced no, pipelines that integrate results from multiple variants or mutation callers, specifically by performing graph realignment of the various calls to resolve the different predictions. This allows users to take advantage of the strengths and multiple variant prediction methods and converge on the most reliable results. In this example, a unified prediction is made from Washington University, Broad, University of Utah, and University of Michigan variant callers. Variant calls from Pindell, GATK, and Freebase are combined and then realigned to a graph reference, and that allows them to be recalled more robustly. And the same approach can be applied to mutation calls. Now, easy-to-use genome analysis tools are also being provided as visualization apps on the web, similar to apps on a smartphone. A growing collection of these apps, called iobio apps, are available for easy real-time visual analysis of genomic data. Well, moving on beyond our genome sequencing program, following a one-year break from its annual gathering, the Advanced DNA Sequencing Technology Development Program will hold a grantee meeting in San Diego in May. After the one-day grantee meeting, there will be a meeting open to the public. Participants will share their latest progress on DNA sequencing technology development and ongoing challenges to further reduce the time and cost of sequencing whole genomes while improving data quality. The goal of the Encyclopedia of DNA Elements, or ENCODE project, is to create a catalog of all functional elements in the human and mouse genomes and to make those catalogs available as a resource to the biomedical community. NHGRI will be holding a small planning workshop entitled From Genome Function to Biological Insight, ENCODE and Beyond in March. And the goal of this workshop is to obtain community input on possible future scientific directions in the area of genome function, following the conclusion of the current phase of ENCODE in 2016. The outcomes of this workshop will be discussed at the May meeting of this council. Meanwhile, the annual ENCODE Consortium meeting will also be held in March. At that gathering, ENCODE members will present updates on their project and discuss ENCODE publication plans, emphasizing the importance of releasing high-quality data to the community in the form of an encyclopedia of candidate functional elements. And ENCODE is also planning a community meeting, a users meeting, which will take place in late June. Consortium members will lead hands-on workshops on how to use ENCODE data, while community members will be invited to make presentations on how they are using ENCODE data. The users meeting is open to any scientists interested in using ENCODE data, although registration is not yet open. In terms of ENCODE publications, the ENCODE-funded publication list includes over 370 papers by the ENCODE Consortium participants and over 148 publications by ModENCODE Consortium participants, collectively depicted by the purple parts of these graphs that you see, or the bars. There are at least 686 community publications from groups using ENCODE data but without ENCODE funding, and at least 165 community publications from groups using ModENCODE data but without ModENCODE funding. And those are collectively depicted as the blue part of those bars. Some of you might have seen that the mouse ENCODE, which is funded as a separate entity, initially with ERA funds from about 2009 to 2012. But this group recently published an integrative paper featured on the cover of Nature in November that compared DNA elements in the mouse and human genomes. In addition to that Nature paper, there were nine companion papers that were also published in a number of journals, including Nature, Genome Research, PNAS, and Science. New to sort of our genome function world at the Institute is this new program, the Genomics of Gene Regulation Project. And the goal of this GGR project, as we refer to it, is to learn how to derive predictive gene regulatory networks starting from genomic data. In January, NHGRI issued five awards totaling more than $28 million over 3 years. With these new grants, researchers will study gene networks and pathways in different biological systems, including the immune system, skin, and nuclear hormone receptor response. The resulting insights into the mechanisms controlling gene expression may ultimately lead to new avenues for developing treatments for diseases affected by faulty gene regulation. Moving on to our Centers of Excellence in Genomic Science, or CEGS program, two new CEGS awards have been made. The goal of the CEGS at Stanford University is to develop technologies to interrogate interactions of the genome with its regulatory proteins and non-coding RNAs, integrating variations in DNA sequences and chromatin states over time and across individuals, and using small samples to capture genome-wide information in a clinical workflow. The new CEGS at Harvard Medical School will build from an existing neuropsychiatric biobank to develop and use bioinformatics and cellular neurobiology tools, along with assessment of cognition and other phenotypes, to understand the cross-disorder mechanism of action of disease liability genes. The CEGS is being largely funded by our CEGS partner, the National Institute of Mental Health, NIMH. The CEGS annual grantee meeting was hosted in October by Aviv Regev and colleagues of the Broad Institute, and it was another productive gathering of these grantees. And finally, recent CEGS grant applications will be discussed later during the closed session of this council meeting. New CEGS applications, meanwhile, are due in May, and it's not too early for potential applicants to contact program staff. After nearly 8 years of service, the Trans-NIH Genetic Association Information Network Data Access Committee, called the GAIN-DAC, has been retired, and the 10 data sets have been moved to the relevant other NIH DACs. Now, the GAIN-DAC was one of the first NIH Data Access Committees established, and it played a significant role in helping to shape the implementation of the GWAS data sharing policy and the DBGAP access process. During its 8 years of service, the GAIN-DAC received nearly 1,700 project requests from 878 U.S. and international investigators from academic institutions, not-for-profit organizations, and companies. And the cumulative pace of such requests since 2007 is shown in the bar graph. For all their hard work, we're extremely grateful to members of the GAIN-DAC, including the chair for the past 8 years, Ann Ramos, and all current and former members of the group for serving, and also for Katya serving as a program analyst and the entire DBGAP team. The NHGRI GWAS catalog is a curated, downloadable, user-friendly resource that catalogs the findings from published genome-wide association studies. Produced in collaboration with the European Bioinformatics Institute, this past quarter, the GWAS catalog team cataloged its 15,000th variant and 2,100th paper. Beginning in March, the GWAS catalog content and search interface will migrate to the European Bioinformatics Institute under the leadership of Helen Parkinson and Paul Fleisig, recipients of a recent U41 grant to make further informatics and curation improvements to this widely used resource. Catalog users are being alerted to this transition on the NHGRI GWAS catalog homepage and can sign up to receive email updates about the transition. Now, the EBI GWAS catalog page is currently under development and will be linked to the NHGRI GWAS catalog homepage as soon as it is available. Investigators in the eMERGE network leverage data from large biorepositories linked to electronic medical records to conduct genomic discovery and clinical implementation research. In the final year of its second phase, the network is actively disseminating its products and best practices among the broader scientific community. As part of the eMERGE PGX project, investigators are collecting sequence data for 82 pharmacogenomic genes from a target cohort of 9,000 subjects. The network has been cataloging variants and the related information on its publicly available web-based resource, Sphinx. To date, Sphinx includes information about nearly 5,000 unique samples and nearly 26,000 variants associated with 60 pathways and relevant information for 515 drugs. At the American Medical Informatics Association Symposium in November, eMERGE investigators received a Distinguished Paper Award for Electronic Phenotyping and the Homer R. Warner Award for their exportable software that protects biobank participant privacy. eMERGE will also lead two panel discussions and three workshops at the upcoming meeting of this group, Translational Bioinformatics and Clinical Research Informatics Summit, sponsored by this association, that's going to be held in March of this year. The Consensus Measures of Phenotypes and Exposures, or Phoenix Project, has produced an online research of standard measures related to common diseases, phenotypic traits, and environmental exposures. Use of Phoenix measures facilitates combining data from a variety of studies and makes it easier for investigators to expand a study design beyond the primary research focus. As a result of NIMH-funded supplement to this U41 cooperative agreement, Phoenix developed a new collection of measures focused on suicide and post-traumatic stress disorder. These measures were released in the toolkit in December of 2014. The interest in the Phoenix process and toolkit continues to grow, and so NHLBI, for example, has provided funds to launch a new sickle cell disease working group. And the working group is just getting off the ground, and measures will be developed over the next year. And then lastly, Phoenix has worked closely with Vanderbilt's REDCap database team to make the standard protocols from three Phoenix domains available in REDCap. The group plans to make 5 monthly releases in 2015 for the remaining 18 domains. The Phoenix Library will have a total of 429 protocols and are expected to become the biggest library in REDCap. The Population Architecture Using Genomics and Epidemiology, or PAGE program, focuses on identifying and characterizing genomic variants associated with common disease in ancestrally diverse populations. PAGE investigators, in collaboration with Illumina and the Consortium on Asthma and African Ancestry Populations in the Americas Consortium, recently designed a large-scale 1.7 million marker multi-ethnic genotyping, or MEGA array, that facilitates discovery of genomic variants in multi-ethnic populations. Building upon existing resources, such as the African Diaspora Power Chip and previous human core and human exome arrays, PAGE investigators added a more robust multi-ethnic GWAS scaffold based on the 1,000 Genomes Project data. Functional variants drawn from a database such as ClinVar and OMIM, and new exomic variants based on 36,000 multi-ethnic exome sequences, as well as additional custom content around loci relevant to PAGE-related traits. And the array is being made available to the scientific community for improved characterization of non-European ancestry samples at a cost of about $75 each. The purpose of the clinical genome research, or ClinGen, is to create a centralized repository and interconnected resource of clinically relevant genomic variants for both the clinical and research communities. ClinGen investigators are working closely with NCBI and clinical laboratories to standardize the clinical assessment of genomic variants and the process of submitting them into the ClinVar database. And as shown here, there has been a steady increase in submissions to ClinVar. In fact, as of January of this year, there are over 129,000 genomic variants represented in ClinVar. Now, ClinGen recently launched a patient portal called Genome Connect. Patients enter phenotypic information and genetic testing reports to Genome Connect through the Patient Crossroads Registry platform and have the option to connect with researchers and other families and individuals with the same genomic variant or variants. And then in May of this year, ClinGen will host a large public meeting with the Sanger Institute's group that oversees Decipher, the database of chromosomal imbalance and phenotype in humans using ensemble resources, Decipher. ClinGen is looking forward to forging an international collaboration focused on the curation of genomic variants with this group. The Newborn Sequencing in Genomic Medicine and Public Health, our NSITE program, will explore in a limited but deliberative manner the implications, challenges, and opportunities associated with possible use of genomic sequence information for the care of newborns. The four sites held the inaugural NSITE Steering Committee meeting in September, at which key personnel from each of the sites discussed progress and network-wide projects. Additionally, in December, investigators from the Children's Mercy Hospital site published a paper in Science Translational Medicine describing their experience in using exome and genome sequencing to diagnose neurodevelopmental disorders in children, including newborns, within their neonatal intensive care unit. For nearly 50% of the cases, a change in clinical care or impression of the pathophysiology was reported. Moving on to genomics and society issues and programs, the Genomics and Society Working Group of this council is charged with providing advice on short and long-term planning and priority setting for the genomics and society activities of the Institute. The working group will hold its next in-person meeting in April. As the working group enters its third year, the founding members are starting to reach the end of their terms. So I'd like to thank outgoing members Tim Caulfield, Jeff Long, Andrea Pantanoud, and David Williams. I greatly appreciate their service to the Institute. And at the same time, I want to welcome council members Shanita Hughes-Halbert, Barbara Bernhardt of the University of Pennsylvania, and David Venstra of University of Washington, all of whom will be joining the working group. Finally, after successfully leading the working group since its inception in 2012, Pamela Sankar will be stepping down from her role as chair, and current working group member Lisa Parker has agreed to serve as the next chair, and my thanks to both of them for continued contributions to this important working group. In December, NHGRI issued a notice announcing its an expansion of its participation in the Ruth L. Kirstein National Research Service Award, NRSA, Institutional Training Grant Program, so as to accept applications focused on training the next generation of LC researchers. The goal of this initiative is to support training experiences that provide an opportunity for pre- and postdoctoral training that provide an opportunity to develop multidisciplinary, conceptual, and methodological skills necessary to pursue independent careers as an LC researcher. And the first applications for this are due in late May for possible funding in the spring of 2016. In terms of our Centers of Excellence in LC Research, or CEER program, the first regional CEER networking meeting for trainees and investigators is being held at the University of Washington in late February. The purpose of this meeting is to provide a more sustained training and networking experience for trainees associated with CEERs in the western half of the country, many of whom are unable to travel to the annual meetings that are typically held on the East Coast. The next annual gathering of CEER investigators will be held in March in Baltimore. And finally, a concept clearance for the next request for applications, or RFA, for the CEER program we discussed later in the open session of this council. So that gets us through our extramural research program. Let me just now touch on Common Fund and trans-NIH efforts of interest, starting with the Human Microbiome Project, which is now in its phase two, and which is also known as Integrative HMP, or IHMP, to reflect its goal of producing integrated multi-omic data from DNA, RNA, protein, and metabolites from the host and microbiome, with the resulting data set serving as a community resource. Now, the IHMP marker paper, which describes the data being produced in three longitudinal cohort studies of preterm birth, inflammatory bowel disease onset, and type 2 diabetes onset, was published as an open access paper in Cell, Host, and Microbe in the early fall. The NIH Common Fund provided an additional $5.75 million to support an IHMP Data Coordination Center, which will be hosted at the University of Maryland. And the second annual IHMP Consortium meeting will be held in June of this year in Bethesda, while the fifth International Human Microbiome Consortium Congress will take place in March in Luxembourg. And over 500 participants are expected at this latter gathering, including 60 invited speakers representing 13 countries from four continents. The Knockout Mouse Phenotyping Project, COMP2, is funded jointly by the NIH Common Fund and 18 other NIH institutes and centers. It was launched in 2011, with the goal of making and phenotyping 2,500 mouse knockout strains over 5 years. COMP2 investigators met with their international mouse phenotyping consortium partners at their annual meeting in November. The meeting was intense, with the first day involving a data update involving 150 consortium members, and the second day involving summary presentations and feedback sessions with a panel of scientific consultants. The COMP2 program team is developing an agenda for a focus group meeting in March to help develop a proposal for renewal of the COMP2 program for a second 5 years of support by the NIH Common Fund. And finally, in light of a new policy on including sex as a biological variable in research design, the current phenotyping data from knockout mice was analyzed for sexual dimorphism. Preliminary analyses reveal that approximately 10% of phenotypes show this effect. And the COMP2 data was presented to the NIH Office of Research on Women's Health in November and is the subject of ongoing analyses. Moving on to another Common Fund project, LINX, aims to create a network-based understanding of biology by cataloging changes in gene expression and other cellular processes that occur when cells are exposed to a variety of perturbing agents. Now, LINX uses computational tools to integrate this diverse information into a comprehensive view of normal and disease states that can be applied for the development of new biomarkers and therapeutics. The LINX pilot phase has concluded, and phase two awards were made shortly after the September Council meeting. This included the funding of 6 data and signature generation centers and one NIH-initiated joint BD2K LINX Data Coordination and Integration Center. The first TransLinks meeting involving investigators in all of these centers was held in October, after which the external scientific panel generated a report on the program's progress. All of the centers have now developed milestones for release of data and tools. And finally, an announcement has now been published about the Data Coordination and Integration Center's plan to solicit and support several specific short-term data science research collaborations. These aim to enhance interactions between outside investigators and LINCS, as well as to bring in novel expertise and analytical capabilities to the LINCS program. H3 Africa's central goal is to develop a sustainable and collaborative African genetics and genomics research enterprise. The fifth H3 Africa Consortium meeting took place in November in Tanzania. Highlights included the presence of trainees and study coordinators at the meeting, with a well-attended grant writing workshop and study coordinator-led discussion session. The meeting was actually preceded by an NHLBI-sponsored sickle cell disease workshop that attracted about 145 participants from 18 countries. H3 Africa has been given supplemental funds to perform whole genome sequencing of more than 300 samples, with resulting data used to design a pan-African custom genotyping chip that will be put into production in May of this year. And a supplement was given to develop a genetics and genomics training module for research ethics committees in Africa. Topics will include informed consent, community engagement, and data and sample sharing. Meanwhile, recent H3 Africa publications include proceedings from the May ethics meeting, as well as a letter to the editor of The Scientist by Francis Collins and Jeremy Farr, who's the head of the Wellcome Trust, responding to an article criticizing the lack of basic science research funding for African scientists. And this letter discussed how H3 Africa is a prototype example of an effort aiming to address this problem. Finally, the next H3 Africa Consortium meeting will be held in May in Zambia, and this will then be followed by a consortium meeting in October of this year in Washington, D.C., which will be held immediately after the annual ASHG meeting in Baltimore. The NIH Common Fund's Undiagnosed Diseases Network, or UDN, aims to improve the level of diagnosis and care for patients with undiagnosed diseases, facilitate research into the etiology of these diseases, and create an integrated and collaborative research community to identify and share improved options for optimal patient care. In September, Baylor College of Medicine and the Medical College of Wisconsin were awarded UDN sequencing core grants to provide centralized genome sequencing for the UDN. These two cores will provide CLIA-level exome and genome sequencing data and clinical reports generated from patients and family members. The full set of different network sites is also shown here on this graphic. The UDN investigators held a steering committee meeting in November, and key personnel from each of the 10 network sites were in attendance to ratify new chapters in the network's manual of operations and to establish standardized procedures for genome sequencing prior to acceptance of the first UDN patient. Meanwhile, six Gene Function Research R21 awards for the UDN were made in August and September. As you can see from this table, these six studies will investigate the underlying genetics, biochemistry, and/or pathophysiology of newly diagnosed diseases in association with gene variants identified through the UDN, in many cases using model systems. Additionally, JAMA published two papers in November by investigators from the Baylor College of Medicine Sequencing Core and the UCLA clinical site describing their experience in using clinical exome sequencing as a diagnostic tool. Moving away from Common Fund, but to still remaining within trans-NIH initiatives, the Trans-NIH Big Data to Knowledge, or BD2K initiative, aims to enable scientists to use big data to advance biomedical research. The first round of awards was made shortly after the last council meeting. This included 12 centers of excellence and the Data Discovery Index Coordination Consortium, with the associated principal investigators gathering at a kickoff meeting in Bethesda in November. At this meeting, it was emphasized that they were expected to function as a consortium. Similarly, the first set of BD2K training awards went out at the end of last fiscal year, and these were for short courses, open educational resources, and mentored career development. The associated principal investigators for the open educational resources also attended that November meeting. There are a number of recently reviewed BD2K elements that will be funded in the upcoming months. One is for software development in four targeted areas of need, data wrangling, compression, visualization, and provenance. The BD2K multi-council working group has reviewed these applications. And a new version of the RFA with different targeted areas will be released later this year. In addition, the training program has completed the review of applications for institutional pre-doctoral training programs in biomedical big data science, and this RFA has a second receipt date in March. In terms of future BD2K efforts and priorities, the Commons is one of the biggest. The goal is to have a space where data, software, and completed analyses are co-located in a cloud environment. Small pilot projects, some of which will be driven by the needs of specific NIH institutes and centers, will be started in the coming months. The NIH Standards Information Resource will be a resource where existing data standards and associated metadata are gathered together, allowing researchers to choose the best existing standard for a data set. Another BD2K group is focused on sustainability of large biological resources. This group is actually going to be hosting a workshop later this year to gather experts both within and outside of biomedicine to come up with possible solutions to the growing problem of sustaining biomedical data resources. The BD2K training group has released an RFA for a Biomedical Data Science Training Coordination Center, which will aim to develop a network of educators, mentors, and trainees, and to produce an index for publicly available training materials. Applications for this are due in March. And finally, BD2K is also focused on creating a diverse biomedical data science workforce. An RFA was posted in January to support creative educational activities that increase diversity, focusing on research experiences and curriculum development. Another thing related to the Common Fund, IDASH is actually a Common Fund center funded as part of the National Centers for Biomedical Computing Program and is dedicated to developing innovative solutions to sharing data for analysis in healthcare and genomics while maintaining privacy. Well, NHGRI funded an IDASH collaborating grant to Indiana University to address issues around privacy with genomic data in particular. And using this funding, this IDASH collaboration will hold the second IDASH Privacy Challenge in March, a workshop to examine security issues related to genome analysis. The two challenge topics for this workshop will be homomorphic encryption and the secure multi-party computing for secure genomic data analysis across institutions. So that wraps up Common Fund Trans-NIH. Moving on then to our Division of Policy, Communications, and Education. Starting with the Inter-Society Coordinating Committee for Practitioner Education and Genomics, called the ISCC, which has continued its work on improving the genomic literacy of healthcare practitioners and enhancing the practice of genomic medicine. Now in August, Terry Manolio and Michael Murray published a paper in Genetics and Medicine about the growing role of professional societies in educating clinicians in genomics. At present, the group's membership includes individuals from professional societies representing physicians, dentists, pharmacists, nurses, and genetic counselors. This past November, the group held its third in-person meeting where members discussed the group's progress to date, developed plans for engaging CME representatives from the 51 professional societies and new federal partners, and created new working groups to address physician-patient communications related to genomics and innovative approaches to the development of educational programs, modeled after the successful program for training pathology residents in genomics. Now, NHGRI's new genomic medicine healthcare, genomic healthcare branch chief, Bob Wilden, is going to take over for Terry Manolio as the NHGRI co-chair of the ISCC, and the group's leaders will continue to explore ways to sustain the ISCC as its scope grows beyond NHGRI's reach. And finally, you'll hear more about the ISCC in a talk by Terry Manolio later in the open session. Now, the Genetics and Genomics Competency Center, or G2C2, website is a free clearinghouse for healthcare provider-oriented educational resources. It's managed by an editorial board and contains competencies for clinical providers from nursing, genetic counseling, physician assistants, and pharmacy disciplines. And I'm now pleased to announce that with the help of a working group of the ISCC, which I just told you about, the site now has physician competencies and peer-reviewed resources. This ISCC working group continues to add resources to this, including journal articles, videos, and teaching method information. And the site has recently been redesigned so that the searchable educational resources for physicians are linked to discipline-specific competency guidelines developed and published by the ISCC. Providers can now target their educational efforts for competencies that they are lacking. Also of interest to members of this council, on December 18th, President Obama signed into law the Newborn Screening Saves Lives Reauthorization Act of 2014, which extends programs supporting newborn screening activities through fiscal year 2019, and reauthorizes the Secretary's Advisory Committee on Heritable Disorders in Newborns and Children. This reauthorization also directs the Department of Health and Human Services to update the Common Rule within 2 years, and importantly requires that until the Common Rule is updated, parental consent is required for the use of newborn blood spot samples in research. This new consent requirement applies to the research use of blood spots collected after March 18th of this year. Also of relevance, over the past year, NIH has rolled out a series of policy changes to enhance stewardship of clinical trial investments. First, in October of 2014, NIH issued a new definition of clinical trial, which went into effect on January 25th. Under the new definition, a clinical trial is a human subject study that is prospective, interventional, and measures health-related outcomes. The definition is significant because it dictates which studies are subject to specific reporting and monitoring requirements. Second, on November 19th, NIH proposed changes to reporting policies. The proposed changes are intended to improve transparency and maximize the utility of research investments by expecting that summary data from NIH-funded clinical trials is reported in clinicaltrials.gov within 12 months of the study's completion. Previously, some smaller trials and some trials that were not FDA-regulated did not have reporting requirements. We anticipate that clear requirements will improve the utility of genomics research data. However, implementation of the policy will require input from the community, and NIH is accepting public comments through February 19th. Finally, on December 3rd, NIH proposed a new policy promoting a single IRB of record for multi-site studies. Having one IRB for a multi-site study is aimed at streamlining review processes and expediting study launch. The public comment period for this proposal closed January 29th. Well, the 5 months since our last council meeting has seen quite a bit of action with regard to FDA's decision to exercise oversight over laboratory-developed tests, or LDTs. Currently, if a molecular diagnostic test is developed and only performed in a single laboratory, it is classified as an LDT and receives no FDA oversight. In contrast, a similar diagnostic test that is marketed as a kit and sold to multiple labs has been subject to FDA oversight for many years. As reported to Council at the September meeting, the FDA recently laid out in draft guidance those aims that basically hope to level the playing field. So during the 120-day public comment period on the draft guidance, FDA held a 2-day workshop to hear public testimony and stimulate discussion. Several NHGRI staff members acted as moderators for panel discussions, and over the course of those 2 days, the agency heard a wide range of views and opinions from stakeholders. The debate over the appropriate level of FDA regulation for diagnostics is also being conducted in the literature, including a pair of commentaries in JAMA at the beginning of January. One by Joshua Sharfstein argues in favor of FDA regulating LDTs, while a second, written by Council's own Jim Evans and ACMG's Mike Watson, argues against such a move. Although the public comment period for FDA's LDT guidance is now closed, the community has another opportunity to advise the agency on how best to regulate the use of next-generation DNA sequencing in diagnostic testing. And last year, FDA published a white paper on the challenges of regulating next-generation DNA sequencing assays compared to more traditional in vitro diagnostics that have more clearly defined intended uses. And FDA is now holding a public workshop at NIH on February 20th specifically to explore this topic. NHGRI has for many years maintained an online resource for issues pertaining to informed consent processes for genomics research. An update to this informed consent resource went live on genome.gov just last week. The website is designed to help researchers and IRBs consider informed consent issues that are specific to the context of genomic science. It includes discussion of topics essential to genomics research, such as consideration of families, studies involving children, and broad versus specific consent. It also includes sample language and consent forms, as well as a discussion
of relevant regulations and policies. Now, some of the new and updated content relates to data repositories and biobanking, whole genome and whole exome sequencing, data sharing, and return of results. And thanks to many reviewers, including some council members, who provided feedback during the development of this updated resource. We hope that this is a valuable resource to the community, and we're actively interested in getting comments or suggestions. In fact, there's a dedicated area for information exchange and sharing of useful consent language, and we give, particularly here, an email address that you can use. Well, as the Genome Unlocking Life's Code exhibition ended its tenure at the National Museum of Natural History and began its North American tour, a closing symposium was held in September to explore the importance of genomic advances and what the next decade holds for genomics and genomic medicine. More than 300 people filled the Baird Auditorium at the museum to hear a series of panels. One included me and Anne Wojcicki of 23andMe and Rick Lifton from Yale. Another one featured Pardis Sabeti from Broad and Harvard and Charles Rotimi from NHGRI and Seema Kumar from Johnson & Johnson. Panelists discussed the future of human genomics, where research is headed, the role of a private citizen in genomic testing and research, and genomics and global health. Then in the evening, we convened another panel for the public, and they were treated to a conversation featuring Washington Post advice columnist Carolyn Hacks and Barbara Biesecker from NHGRI, and also Dave Valley from Johns Hopkins. And the panelists answered audience questions about health issues, genetics, dealing with diseases, and their personal life. Well, realizing that Genome Unlocking Life's Code traveling exhibition would make its first stop in San Diego at the Reuben H. Fleet Center, NHGRI was presented with a wonderful opportunity to highlight the exhibition and to work with some of the local organizations that provide on-the-ground support to military families in the San Diego area. So in November, NHGRI partnered with the San Diego Military Family Collaborative to host a Military Family Day at the Fleet Center. More than 700 people from military families ranging from infants in arms to retired military attended the event. Military families were able to visit the Fleet Science Center at no charge, participate in genomics-focused hands-on activities with scientists from local universities and organizations, and also, of course, to see the actual exhibition, get a complimentary lunch, and receive information from more than 30 San Diego area resource providers. But the exhibition had to uproot from San Diego to keep moving. And so the Genome Unlocking Life's Code exhibition is now in the middle of its busy travel schedule around North America. The first stop was San Diego, but that concluded on January 2nd, during which time more than 50,000 people visited the exhibition over those 3 months. But it now travels and has traveled up to the Tech Museum of Innovation in San Jose, where it will reside until the end of April. After San Jose, it's on to my hometown, St. Louis, until mid-September, and then on to Portland, Oregon, until the very beginning of next year. And then the first destination for 2016, which Howard Jacobs just waiting for, will be Milwaukee, where it will be from January until the end of April of next year. And each of these destinations, I can tell you, NHGRI is working in partnership with science centers, universities, communities, and also our grantees to develop programs for targeted populations, as well as reaching out to the local health professionals. And as always, just check the exhibition's website at unlockinglifescode.org for the most up-to-date information on where the exhibition is traveling and any programming associated with it. Finally, getting to the home stretch here. Intramural research program at NHGRI, but before I talk about our specific intramural program, I should actually tell you that in the middle of last year, Francis Collins established a yet another working group of his advisory committee to the director. This one focused on long-term strategic planning for the broader NIH intramural research program. The working group was charged with identifying new areas of opportunity for the intramural research program, approaches to capitalize on its uniqueness, and ways to ensure its healthy and productive future. I can tell you that Councilmember Bob Nussbaum actually served on this working group. In December, the working group delivered its report, which contains recommendations for a number of structural and strategic changes, including the creation of a trans-NIH intramural innovation fund and modifications to the existing routines for external review of intramural investigators. And the NIH leadership, including institute directors and scientific directors, are now working to decide which of the recommended elements will be implemented and how to implement them. In terms of some accolades for some of our own intramural investigators, Julie Segre, senior investigator and chief of the NHGRI Translational and Functional Genomics Branch, was selected for the 2014 Chanel Series Research Award. She received this honor in recognition of her research on the microbiome of human skin. Bill Gall, our Institute's clinical director and director of the NIH Undiagnosed Diseases Program, received the 2014 Rare Voice Award in the government agency category. This award recognizes organizations and individuals who go above and beyond to become policy leaders and political advocates in their state and nation. Barb Biesecker, associate investigator in the NHGRI Social Behavioral Research Branch, received the Natalie Weisberger Paul National Achievement Award. This annual award is given to the most distinguished award given by the National Society of Genetic Counselors and honors an outstanding individual whose exemplary national achievements and volunteer activities have served the society and the profession. And Charles Ratimi, chief of the NHGRI Metabolic, Cardiovascular, and Inflammatory Disease Genomics Branch and director of the NIH Center for Research on Genomics and Global Health, received the 2014 South African Medical Research Council Scientific Merit Award for his seminal scientific contribution, the award reflecting his longstanding record of important role he has played in performing genetics and genomics research. And finally, Sherjo Sen, formerly a postdoctoral research fellow who was until recently tri-mentored by Les Biesecker and Jim Mulliken and actually me, received the 2014 C.W. Cotterman Award from the American Society for Human Genetics. Sergio's paper entitled Integrative DNA, RNA, and Protein Evidence Connects Trommel 4 to Coronary Artery Calcification was published in the July 2014 issue of the American Journal of Human Genetics. And this paper was selected as one of two publications within the previous year that represented outstanding contributions to the field of genetics, earning Sergio a 2014 C.W. Cotterman Award. Other highlights within the intramural program since the last council meeting, Charles Ratimi and colleagues involved in the African Genome Variation Project published the first comprehensive characterization of genomic diversity across sub-Saharan Africa. The paper was published in Nature. Julie Segre and her NCI collaborators published their genomic study of the metagenome of 18 skin sites, revealing the unique microbiota of each. That research was also published in Nature. And then Chuck Venditti and colleagues published the results of their study of adeno-associated viral vectors for gene therapy in mouse models of methemolonic acidemia, describing important factors in gene delivery that are critical in the subsequent development of hepatic cancer. And this paper was published in the Journal of Clinical Investigation. Before ending my director's report, I just want to put in a plug and say anyone wishing to receive my monthly email update, The Genomics Landscape, simply go to this listserv and information provided, and you can certainly enroll. Our numbers grow every month. And finally, a personal thanks to everyone who helped put this very busy director's report, very busy time for the past 4 months, put it all together and pull in all the slides and information to convey all this to council and others watching in. Particular thanks, as always, to Chris Wetterstrand, who's the ringleader of all of this and makes the final PowerPoint slides come together. But also our communications group who are helping make this widely available on the web. And that was a long director's report, but before I end, I just want to do two more brief things just to show you how crazy things have been. I want to share one funny story and then tell you one serious thing. The funny story is that you could tell it has been a crazy 4 months or something since, and especially in the roll-up or all the events leading out to the announcement of the president's precision medicine initiative. Many of us were doing just heroic things with all of the documents going back and forth and all the planning going back and forth. So we had enough on our plate already. And then the president's announcement was on the Friday. And about Tuesday evening, it started to be, Laura Rodriguez and I, in particular, started to get emails from the White House, in particular. The reason and this reflects sort of the day in the life of the NHGRI. In fact, I may add this as a new slide in my director's report because there always seems to be something happening every 4 months that's insane. This would be the insane category, as if there wasn't enough going on. Laura and I were both exquisitely busy when we start getting emailed from the White House because people there, especially in the Office of Science, Technology, and Policy, knew that immediately outside my office is this nice model of a double helix. And this is the view from my desk. So if we zoom in a little, this is my immediately outside my office. And they knew it was there, and they wanted it for the announcement. And they said, get it to us, and we need it, like, and the next morning, we were told at like 5 in the morning, we need it today, because they probably want to clear it to do all things, and they want to make sure they have everything ready 2 days in advance. And so this is an icon of the institute. In fact, you see two pictures you saw on the right where the photographers love to take pictures of staff with this thing. I've had it for 20 years, and it's been used many, many times. And maybe that's part of the reason why the White House wanted this as sort of an icon next to the president. And so this thing's a little fragile, but we had to somehow get it to the White House. So we don't have enough to do. Here we are boxing the darn thing up in a very kludgy way. My assistant Annette was tasked with this at 6, right. Oh no, I'm getting there. This is 6:30 in the morning, or maybe 7:30 in the morning. Here we are coming up with a kludgy way to brace it so that a courier could take it down to the White House. We had to like cap it off and get it all set and, you know, tape it up.
It's a lot of tape, yeah.
A lot of tape. It did take some extra effort to get it through the Secret Service. But they were motivated, and there it was. That's the picture from Isaiah, waiting for the president, and waiting for the president to come out. And eventually he did come out, and he just loved it. In fact, he pointed out how DNA and genomics just rocks. And so the double helix is now famous because it's got to be next to Obama. Now, I will tell you, because some of you probably did, am I going to get it back? And am I going to get it back as a model or a box of G's, A's, T's, and C's? That's what I was worried about, but they actually took great care of it, and this is a picture I took of it Saturday afternoon. It is back where it belongs, and I don't have to worry about it anymore. So that was my humorous story. My more serious story, which actually is really directed at the council. So I had an odometer moment, as I called it. December 1 of 2 months ago or something like that was my fifth year as rec, which some people are shocked by. In some ways, I'm sort of shocked by. And a lot has happened, obviously, in 5 years. Actually, I was reminiscing the fact that we've lost several council members from being here in person because of the snow. My first council, which was exactly 5 years ago now, happened. Obviously, I started December 1st. First council meeting was in February, and I got all ready for it, and it was very fast, and it was all very new for me. And then we got hit with a snowmageddon, and we ended up, no council members came to it because there was no way you can get in town, and we took it all by phone. We converted it all by phone. So I'm very sympathetic to these crazy things that happen when we have February council meetings, but such we have to do with it. But it's been great. I feel like things have gone extremely well. I've made many thanks to members of the Institute at that magic 5-year odometer moment. But I actually wanted to make sure to thank Council because it was also, I think, very relevant to point out that I think we've done a lot to enhance how we use our Council and enhance the relationship with Council over the 5 years I've been director. And I think it's working. I rely on you, as does all the staff, constantly, extensively. And I will tell you that it really came into focus in thinking about this last week, when last week happened to be the week I make the phone calls to invite the new slate, the new members, which we'll eventually be hearing about. We will nominate these individuals now, 4 new members. And I have phone conversations, as I have with each of you, and really just stressed what an incredibly good relationship it is between council members and the Institute, in particular me. And so I just want to really personally thank all of you for your valued input and some of you have seen me over the 4 out of those 5 years, especially those who are getting near the end, or at least 3 of the 5 years, for those getting near the end of your tenure on council. But just my own personal thanks to all of you. I think this is a terrific group to interact with. We take your meetings very seriously. We take your advice very seriously. And I really regard it as one of the special parts of the job. So I know that was a lengthy director's report. I knew it was going to be, but thank you for your attention. Happy to take any questions. And Rudy's not going to let too many questions. I'm sure we're going to be on a clock now. But Bob.
One quick comment. Congratulations on transfecting the White House.
Yeah, there you go.
I just wanted to ask you a question about the cohort issue. I didn't hear any mention of the Million Veterans Project and sort of what the relationship is there.
Without question, all available cohorts, including the Million Veterans, is going to be part of the conversation. And certainly, they're going to be prominently, they're definitely present at the workshop. And remind me if anybody like Terry remembers, are they giving a presentation at the workshop? But
Michael Gaziano from the VA is giving a presentation.
There you go.
The Million Veterans cohort as an example of a large cohort in the United States.
Absolutely part of the discussion. And nothing, again, like a lot of things, to be determined exactly how all this works. But no question, they've been part of the conversation from the beginning.
If you need partial liaison, I'm on their advisory committee.
And I did know that, and this has come up, and that's good to know. Yeah, Tony.
I just wanted to know whether there's been thought put into collaborating or learning from the UK Biobank, which has 500,000. I think they started in 2006.
And we absolutely know that, and I know Rory is coming. Here, come here, right here. Rory's coming to the workshop.
Yeah, he's actually a critical part of our working group, and I'm actually on their advisory board as well, so we're using their lessons.
There's no question maximizing these cross-fertilization is going to be critical. Never was the idea of do this in isolation, build it from scratch. All this is to broker off of existing expertise and cohorts. Yes, Dan.
This is sort of like a bureaucratic question, but who's going to run this thing? What institute is going to, where is it going to live?
All to be determined, at least initially. I think it's being right now shaped in a trans-NIH way. All aspects of it are going to be to broker the expertise of what currently exists in many institutes. With time, when it's taken more shape and we understand what's going to be needed, those sorts of governance issues, I think, will be fleshed out in greater detail. Yes, Carlos.
Eric, is the so first, I want to mention what I mentioned on the other call that we were on about making sure that the cohort is diverse and representative and properly powered, which is a big issue, right? You know, that one of the big hurdles in multi and trans-ethnic mapping is that, you know, when you look at the minority groups, they often tend to have smaller sample sizes, and so you can't do primary discovery in those groups, and it's really important that that be part of the design, and as I know that's on the forefront of what you're thinking about. The other is, you know, as you're building the cohort, is there a plan to do, say, genotyping of all million people in year one? Because that could be a pretty amazing resource before you start doing the sequencing, or is it all going to be, you know, sequence in year five after you've built the cohort, or is that all sort of up in the air?
I would say this is all up in the air. I mean, it's exactly what starting Wednesday will be discussed. There is nothing etched in anything other than very light pencil, which was mostly related to get a bunch of people together for an initial workshop as quick as possible.
Because strategically, right, you may want to pick off all the relatively common variants first by genotyping, and you know you're going to want that data anyway for quality control. So thinking about a staggered model might be something that those going to the meeting might want to consider.
Okay. Rudy, I'll turn this over to you.
Yeah, so please be back from lunch at 12:45, then we'll start with Terry's presentation on the Genomic Medicine Working Group. So 12:45, back here, please.
Oh, no.
I don't think anyone around this table.